Okay, so there is going to be another homework coming out. This is not a written homework, it's a lab-like homework on EC2 and cloud computing. I will put it up today, but it's going to be due next week after the exam. So I'm assuming most of you won't look at it until afterwards, but just wanted to announce that this homework 3 is going to be on the cloud. So today we will start a different topic on distributed file systems. So we have covered most of the basic topics already, okay, whether it's process and thread management, virtualization. We looked at canonical problems in distributed systems, replication, caching, not caching, replication, fault tolerance, and so on. So what remains is distributed file systems and a little bit of an overview on security, and then the remaining 4 or 5 classes will be mostly case studies of actual systems, whether it's the web or middleware systems or other kinds of distributed systems that are out there. Okay, so this is one of the two more advanced topics, and then case studies are the only thing that remain. So what I'll do today is start with a quick overview. So this is going to be a distributed file system. Start with a quick overview of Unix file systems just to set the context, and we will try to understand how distributed file systems are different in terms of even semantics and how they are similar. Okay. We will then talk today about NFS. Okay. And then next time we'll talk about some other file systems that are used or being designed as part of research projects, try to understand how they are different from NFS, which is clearly widely used and commercially available. And then towards the end, if we have time, we look at things like RAID, lock structured file systems, and object storage systems. And that will be more brief. Okay, do a brief discussion. So let's start with the file system basics. So this should be clear. A file is essentially a data container that has a name. Okay, so it's a name collection of logically related data. Okay, there are different ways how file systems treat files. Unix is the most basic method where a Unix file system looks at a file as an uninterpreted sequence of bytes. So what data is inside the file system, or rather inside a file, is not pertinent to the file system. Any data could be stored and the file system doesn't care. Okay, as opposed to, let's say, file systems that you have in Windows that have a file type associated with it. Okay, so files are typed and the type of the file indicates what kind of data is stored in it. Yeah, so you could have either of those two. So the file system allows you to store data on your hard disk. It allows you an easy abstraction to get to those that data. Okay, user don't have to worry about how files are stored on blocks, where they are stored, so long as you have the name of the file, which is what users provide, you can get to your data. Okay? And you have lots of functions that allow you to create, delete files, organize them in directories, and so on. Scan protection. So this is a review from undergrad OS class. Files are linear array of bytes. Okay, files could have types or not have types. There are structured file systems where not only files are types, but files have a structure. Okay. This is mostly present in mainframe-like systems where you can create file structures and say a file is a collection of records rather than a collection of bytes, and each record has a certain size. Those types of files are typically used by database applications, for instance. Okay, so you can store record-oriented files as opposed to just arbitrary bytes. Okay. You have directories. Okay, the directories are collections of files that allow you to group them in some reasonable way so you can get to them later. Directories may have subdirectories and so on. As far as the file system is concerned, a directory is simply another file. Okay? And that file is a table that indicates what real files are present in that directory and a pointer to metadata for that file. Okay? So if you actually look at the contents of a directory, it's essentially a special file that simply stores the names of other files that are present in that directory. That's how you create the abstraction of it. Okay. The directory entry for each of the file will include the file name. Okay. It will include a metadata information, which is referred to as in Unix terminology, The metadata is referred to as an inode or an index node. A metadata for a file is data about the data. Okay, that's why it's called metadata. It has information such as username, the owner, size of the file, pointers to blocks, protection information, and so on. There may be other things like the major device number and the minor device number, which indicates what is the type of the device the file is stored on. Is it a hard disk? Is it a USB disk? Is it a CD-ROM drive, and so on. That is what Unix calls a major device number. Okay, this is a device type on which the file is stored. A minor device number is an instance of a major device number. If you have multiple disks, you will have minor device 1, 2, 3, or partitions will have the same kind of information. Okay. Now, clearly to construct a file system, you need to maintain metadata about all of the files that are stored on it. Okay, and metadata are called inodes. Typically on a given file system, whether it's centralized or distributed, okay, you have special blocks that are called super blocks that are associated or created to store metadata information. Okay, so if you have a typical file system, okay, let's say that's a disk. Okay, a disk is a collection of blocks. When the file system is formatted, certain blocks are marked off as special blocks. They are called super blocks, and those are the blocks in which file metadata is going to be stored. Okay, so you will actually create empty inodes or metadata information. So when you want to create a file, you go and look for an empty entry and allocate that inode to a particular file, and then all the information about that file is stored in that inode, and there will be pointers to actual data. Okay, so that's referred to as metadata. So inodes are stored on a special and known location, which allows you to go and access them. Data blocks can be stored anywhere on disks. Okay? Inodes are stored in known locations so that you can get to them. Okay? There has to be some way. In order to get to a file, you have to first get to the metadata. And you need to know where the metadata is stored in order for you to figure out where the blocks are stored. Okay? So this is the structure of an inode, okay? Typically a typical structure. There is owner ID, group ID, the directory in which it may be stored, protection bits or access control list, which indicate who is allowed to access the file, do read, write, execute on that file. Last access time, last modification time, size of the file, how large is it, the number of blocks. There may be ref count if multiple aliases point to this file. This ref count is going to be more than one. Typically, it's one. Okay, and then the most important part is pointers to blocks. Okay. So if you know how Unix manages or stores files, you will know that this is a multi-level index structure. Okay. So you will have an inode where the first some number of entries will directly point to data blocks. Okay. And then there's an entry that's going to point to another index blocks, which will themselves point to data. Is referred to a single level index. Okay, then there will be another entry which will point to an index block, which may itself point to multiple index blocks, and they will point to data blocks. So this is a two level index, and you can have a third level index as well. Okay. This is referred to as a multi-level index structure. Okay. Now the reason it is done this way rather than having a complete two level index structure is you want to optimize for the common case, which is most files are small. If you empirically look at any disk, if you take a typical disk on a PC, analyze the file sizes, you will see that most files are small. 80-20 or 90-10 rules apply. And there will be a small number of very large files that take up most of the space. Okay, so most of the space on the disk is taken by a small number of large files. This could be movies or images of that pictures that you've taken. But the average file size tends to be on the something like 4 to 8 kilobytes in size, very small, almost just one or two disk blocks. Okay? So if you want to optimize for the common case, you want to allow those file accessors to be fast. So you have direct blocks here, which allow you to access the inode, and you can figure out where the blocks are stored. As the files get progressively larger, you need to go through multiple levels of indirection to access the later blocks of that file. Okay? So this is Unix philosophy, which is provide efficient access to any file, but the smaller the file, the more optimized the accesses are. Okay? So that's a multi-level index structure that's in an inode. Okay, so this is just quick background. before we move on to distributed file system. Okay, so with that background, now let's ask the question, what happens if you want your file system to span multiple disks? Okay, today we are going to look at disks that are on different machines. Okay, that's why it's a distributed file system. Next time we'll also look at disk arrays such as RAID, where the files span multiple disks, but the disks may be connected to the same machine. So it's a multi-disk struct organization. So we'll start with some basic definitions. So we'll distinguish the file service from the file server. Okay, the file service, think of the file service as the API or the interface your file system or distributed file system provides to clients. That is how clients are going to access data stored on this file system. Okay. File system itself span multiple machines. Okay. Each machine that provides accesses to the data that's stored locally will be referred to as a file server. Clearly, the collection of file servers together will implement the interface or the file service. We will distinguish between the two, as it will be clear why there is a reason to distinguish. Because the API or the interface should be separate from the implementation or the number of machines that are used to implement your file system. Okay. Now, as far as the file service is concerned, we will look at two canonical ways to access files stored on a remote machine. So we have to now assume that you at least have one server and one client. You can have more than one server, but here we are only showing one server and at least one client. Okay, so a typical way to access a file is client requests files that are stored on the server. Every read or write request is going to be sent to the server. The server is going to execute that request and send back the result. If you want to read a certain block of the file, you forward that request to the server. Server performs the read, sends back a response. You want to do a write, to forward that to the server. Okay. So this is called the remote access model, okay, for accessing data. So everything, all accesses are remote. Okay, here is an alternate model called the upload-download model. In this case, what happens is the first time the client accesses the file, a copy of the file, an entire copy of the file is brought over and is either stored locally or cached locally. Okay. All subsequent accesses are local. Okay, meaning all subsequent reads and writes are performed on the local cached copy. Okay? And it's the client's job, if the cached copy is modified, to send those modifications to the server so that the server can update the master copy. Okay? So this is referred to as the upload-download model. Okay? So remote access model or upload-download model. And any file system will either have one or the other or both, as we will see. NFS will actually support both. You can ask what's the difference, what are the advantages and disadvantages. In this case, the server, okay, since there's only one copy, it's easier for the server to maintain consistency because all reads and writes come to the server. Okay. So there may be multiple clients accessing the same file. Since all reads and writes are sent to the server, consistency is easy. As soon as a file is modified by one client, the next client that reads it gets the most up-to-date copy. There's no problem. In this case, you may have to deal with consistency in a more complicated way because there may be multiple clients that are accessing the file. Each of them has their locally cached copy. Okay, now, if client 1 modifies the file, client 2 does not yet know that those modifications have taken place. You may, subsequent reads may access the old version of the file until the first client notifies the server and the server then sends the new changes back to the second. So consistency is somewhat harder, okay, not impossible, it's harder in this case to maintain. Okay. The other advantage is there may be, depending on which one you use, there may be state that you maintain. Okay. In this case, you have to keep state of who is actually caching copies of the file. So if the file is modified, you can then send those changes back. In this case, since all requests are being sent to the server does not have to maintain state. I think this is a typo. This should be stateless and that should be stateful. It's the opposite. Okay. So it depends on consistency. Issues are different in the two scenarios. Whether you're stateful or stateless is different. Okay. And the last but not least, you can ask about the performance of the two scenarios. Okay. So you can ask where, in which of these two models are reads and writes more efficient. Okay, upload, download. Okay, go ahead.
Because once the file is at the client side, then all the operations are happening locally.
Okay, So upload-download model is more, so the suggestion upload-download model is more efficient because initially you have to put in some effort to bring the copy of the file. That entire data has to be copied. But once your copy arrives on your machine, all subsequent reads and writes are local to the machine. Here also reads and writes involve a network hop. So if you just look at the latency of read or the latency of write, it's going to be the time to send the message over a network, the time to perform that operation on the machine, time to get back the result. So every read and write involves a network hop plus a disk access. In this case, every read or write simply involves a local disk access, and the initial work of bringing the file over is going to be amortized across all the reads and writes that are performed on the file. Okay, so as if your file is going to be accessed for a substantial period of time, bringing a copy of the file over and performing local access is going to pay off in the long run. Okay? If you are going to only perform one read or one write, then that extra work may not pay off. Okay, then this may be more efficient even though there is a latency. So there are some trade-offs that you have to look at. Yes?
If a client modifies a file and it notifies the server and upload on the model, does the server tell the other clients that the file has been modified?
Okay. So question is, if the client modifies the file and the server is notified that the file has been modified, should the server notify the other clients? Okay. Now, that depends. The answer to that is it's going to depend on the consistency model. We will look at two different models. One is server-initiated consistency and client-initiated consistency. In server-initiated consistency, as soon as the server knows a data item has been modified, it's the server's responsibility to tell any client that has a copy of the data item that the file has been modified. The client-initiated consistency is the client's job to periodically check with the server whether the data has been modified. So in the upload-download model, if it was server-initiated, as soon as some client sends some changes to the server has to notify other clients. If it's client-initiated, then when you receive modifications, you just store them. You don't notify clients, but then the clients are required to check periodically as the data changed. Okay, so it's going to depend whether it's server or client-initiated. The upload-download model by itself doesn't say which of the two to use. Okay, you can pick either one.
Okay.
The question is, should the client declare whether it's going to open the file in read or write mode? Clearly, when you open the file, you specify the mode. So read, write, or read, write at the system call level. Whether at the library level you do that or not is an orthogonal issue. So at least the client OS knows how the file has been opened. What you tell the server depends on the implementation. We look at NFS and see how it makes these design decisions. So this is more conceptual. Okay, what we will look at is exactly all the questions that you are all asking. How does particular different file systems do it differently? And you will see that depending on how you made these design decisions are made, you are going to get many different scenarios and many different types of trade-offs. Okay. Now, another dimension to whether, regardless of whether you upload, download or not, is whether the client maintains state or the client is stateless. You can, that's a fundamental design decision you have to make. Who keeps state? Okay. And what we mean by state here, state simply means which clients are accessing what files. Okay. You can simply think of in the file system case, minimally that is the state that you have to maintain. Who is accessing what? Okay. Now, if you design that the system has to be stateless, okay, meaning servers have to be stateless, then servers are not going to track this information. The clients themselves know what they are accessing. And then anything that requires state, such as consistency, has to be client-based because the server fundamentally is stateless. Okay. Or you can say that the servers could maintain state. In this case, the servers are allowed to track who is accessing what. They can take charge or responsibility for consistency and so on. Okay, so this is a design decision. Again, we'll see NFS. In fact, we'll see variants of NFS where some are stateless and some are stateful. Now, there are some trade-offs when you maintain state. Okay, so state is not going to be arbitrarily scalable. If you have to keep state, if there are lots of files and lots of clients, you have to still keep track of all of this information. Okay? Typically, the information is tracked in memory. Okay, so if the server crashes, it's keeping state, the state is going to disappear. Okay, so that's another problem when you have stateful servers. is that it's more prone to reliability problems if there is a server. In a stateless system, the advantage is components can crash and recover, but no state is lost from the server's perspective because it doesn't have to maintain any state. Okay, so from a design standpoint, it is more elegant in that you don't have to write complex code to figure out what happened when you recovered. You have to recover the state as well. If there's no state to recover because it's stateless, then it's much easier. Okay, so those are all issues that you will look at, but something to keep in mind. So with that, now let us do our first case study and understand how specific systems make this decision. We looked at whether it's upload, download, or stateless, stateful, consistency, and so on. So we'll start with NFS. That's the first one. This one we'll look at in some detail. And then next time we'll look at more advanced file systems that do a variety of other things and we have made other decisions. So first of all, with some history, NFS is a widely used distributed file system. NFS stands for Network File System. It was designed by Sun Microsystems, which is now Oracle, maybe 20, 30 years ago. If you remember when we were talking about RPCs, I mentioned that RPCs were originally put into a commercial operating system by Sun in order to implement NFS. Yeah, NFS uses RPCs as its underlying mechanism. The first commercial or widely used implementation of RPCs was by Sun OS, and they used it to implement NFS, and then they said the tool is more broadly applicable, so let's also release the RPC compiler for other application developers. Okay, so that's basically just a little bit of history of how this came about. And if you have any Unix environment, Linux, BSD, or any flavor of Unix, you will see that if it's networked, it will be using NFS. In the NightLab, you see that all your home directories are on a server, and when you log into a workstation, any EdLab workstation, your home directory is going to be made accessible over NFS. Okay, the directory is not local. This is the canonical picture for a client. So it's a client-server file system, and this is how NFS, client and server fit into the broader picture. Okay, so this is a client machine, the server machine. Client has a disk, server has a disk where they maintain their local files. The server decides that its local file system should be made available to other machines, and it decides to use NFS. So NFS is going to be a layer that sits on top of the local file system. So local file system provides access to local files. NFS is simply a layer that sits on top that makes these files accessible outside the machine. Okay? NFS is not a replacement for a local file system. It's simply a layer that sits on any local file system you already have. Okay? This is why you see the server code is different from the file system. The server code is simply forwarding requests to the local file system. That's all it is doing. Now, from a Unix standpoint, the architecturally, the way this is done is through this layer called the virtual file system or a VFS layer. This is also called the VFS switch. This is how most Unix file systems will support a whole variety of file systems, including NFS. And what this does is, as follows. So this is your system call interface. Application sits or sit on top. Okay, when an application makes a read or write request to a file, okay, it's going to come through the system call layer, and it first comes to this virtual file system layer, the VFS layer. The VFS layer examines the system call and says what kind of file system is this system call accessing, okay, this read or write request accessing. If it's a local file, okay, it is sent that read or write request or open any of the file system request is sent to the local file system module within the kernel. Okay. If it happens to be a remote file, which in this case, if it's an NFS file in particular, that read and write request is forwarded to the NFS module within the kernel. And the NFS module has to then decide how to process that request subsequently. So this is simply a forwarding layer. You could have other file systems adjacent to this. For instance, if you plug in a USB disk, okay, into your machine, you will have a FAT file system on that. So there will be some code in the kernel that handles FAT files. And so if you are now accessing a file on your USB stick or CD-ROM, that read or write request will be sent to the kernel module that is implementing that particular file system. Okay, so you can have a number of file systems here, and this simply think of it as a big case statement. Here is if then statement. If this is the file type, send that request to this model. If it's some other file type, send it to this model. Okay, so that's all that is happening there. Okay. Now let us assume that you are accessing a remote file on the server. So the read request has come and it's been sent to the NFS client. So now it's NFS client's job to actually talk to the server and get the file or the read that file. So what it is going to do is, since I already mentioned it runs on RPC, the NFS client is going to make an RPC read request. Okay. So that read request is going to go over the network, arrive at the server. So there's a stub here. That read request will then be sent off to the NFS server code. Okay. The server code will look at, examine the read request, okay, do some local processing, and then it was going to simply forward it up to the file system switch. Okay. In this case, the server is acting as a client, as an application, think of it. And then the file system layer will then send it back to the local file system, which will perform the read, and the results will come back over an RPC reply. Is that clear? Okay. So now, with that background, let's look at some file RPC calls or the API that NFS is going to support. This is a large table. We are going to ignore most of these calls here, except for a few. Okay, so first thing I'm going to, so all the standard ones are in there. You can create a file, you can read a file, you can write a file, etc. So the two things I'm going to point out are, there are two columns here, which is NFS version 3 and NFS version 4. Okay. And the reason I'm going to sort of bring this up is, until NFS version 3, which is 1, 2, and 3, the design decision that was made regarding NFS is servers are stateful. Servers cannot maintain any state. Servers, what that also means is the servers don't even know which files are currently open by what client. Okay. So every time you send a read or write request, you have to send complete information saying, I am such and such client, this is the file I need to access, here is the offset of the file, go read or write to this this offset. Okay, entire the request has to be fully descriptive because there is no state. In a local file system, there is state. Once you open a file, there is a file descriptor that comes back to you. Okay, so the OS has kept track of this process, has this file open. So subsequent read or write operations simply provide the file descriptor and you read or write, and the OS knows what file you are trying to read or write. In the NFS server, there is no state. So there is no notion of a file descriptor either. So every time the client has to make a request to the server, everything has to be specified. What is the full name of the file and what offset, what operation you are performing, and so on. Yes.
Is this just according to the spec, or is the implementation itself too? Like, are there custom implementations of this that do caching and things like that, that do keep some state to optimize these things? Or is that...
So that's a good question. So the question is this an interface issue? Is this how it was supposed to be designed, or is this how it was implemented? So I'm going to answer that in just a second. Okay, so let me come to that. It will be clear that it's an interface design decision. It's not an implementation. That's how NFS version 3 has to be implemented. Okay, so just to complete this. So the reason there's a different column here for version 4 is, as of version 4, okay, NFS implementations can be stateful. They are allowed to maintain state. And as a result, you can do certain things in version 4 that you could not do fundamentally in NFS until version 3. Now, with that background, I'm going to point out, just to answer that question and point out certain other things. You will see that if you just look at the open call, this is the call you use to start accessing the file. You will see version 3 does not even support an open. Version 4 supports an open. Okay. So you can ask, so what does that mean? Why do you not have to open a file in order to start accessing it? Now, typically, the way what open calls does is, when you open it, you do perform some checks and you get a file descriptor. That's what a local file system does. And you now have track state saying this process has started accessing this file. Okay. Since version 3 is stateless, okay, there was no need for the open call. Okay. You have another call, which is lookup, which allows you to check whether the file exists, so that the open call, since there's no open, you need to know that there is a file and you're allowed to access it. You do that with lookup, okay? But there is no state that is going to be maintained. But as of version 4, you see that the open now call is now supported, which allows you to send an open request to the server, and the server can track what the client is doing, what client it is, etc. Okay. So this fundamentally means if there is no open, that you cannot make the server stateful even if you wanted to in the implementation. If this is the interface your code implements, you're writing an NFS client or a server, until version 3, you couldn't keep any state because there was no way to tell the server, I opened this file, okay, and then the server now knows that you are a client that's accessing a certain file. Yes.
Why is it that you can't create a directory in NFS version 4?
Which call are you looking at?
RMDA.
Oh, made.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
Like, you can't make a directory or a symlink?
So I think the cause that the API has changed, it's not that you cannot create a directory. What that simply says is that call has been deprecated and not supported. You do this through some other operation.
I see.
And that's all it means. It doesn't mean that you cannot create directories in version 4.
Does that mean the second column is just created?
Yes, you can. Basically, the other thing is you can use a create. The second version of a create can be used to create. So you can do all of those operations, just use different calls. The code has to change. That's all it means. Okay. Now, just to show how you can open a file and start reading it, these are the operations that will take place typically between an NFS client and an NFS server. So when the client or the application says open a file, the application still has to say open because this is all transparent to the application. It just thinks it's accessing a local file, except that the file is removed. So internally, when the open call hits the VFS switch and is sent to the NFS client, it is going to send a lookup request to the server saying, is this file available? Am I allowed to access it based on the credentials that I have? If the client has some provide some credentials. If that call is successful, then any subsequent read or write requests are just sent to the server. If the call fails, then you return an error to open saying either the file doesn't exist or there is some access problem. So that's how you will actually translate your client level requests into RPC requests that go between the client and the server. Okay, this is version 3. As of version 4, okay, there are two things you can do. First of all, you can do the same thing because it's backward compatible. But if your client server actually implements stateful operations, you can also do an open. So you can do a lookup, do all of your checks, see if your file exists, you're allowed to access it and so on. Then you can send an open request. Open request will then tell the server saying this client is accessing the file, it will keep state. And then you can do reads, okay, subsequently. In addition, what version 4 also allows you to do are what are called compound RPCs or batched RPCs. You can make multiple RPC requests in a single message. You can send a batch of RPC requests. That's a performance optimization because here there are multiple round trips between the client and the server. So this is version 4 that has sent 3 RPC requests in one packet saying, look up this file. If that operation is successful, open the file. And by the way, here is the first read request. So all of those 3 can be sent in one compound RPC. And that's, as I said, you can send them as individual RPCs. They will just take 3 round trips. You can also send them as one. Okay, so there are some performance optimization and there is a decision to make it stateful. And we'll see what the stateful decision allows us to do. But I'm just going to pause here to see if there are any questions. Okay. So, yes.
I was thinking, could you send like a runnable or like a task from the client to the server? And the server could just run a bunch of reads and writes.
Come again, what's the question?
Like, could you run like in Java where you have like a runnable set of tasks? Could you do that from the client to the server?
Are you asking what applications can do in order to optimize the request? Is that what you just said? So as far as NFS is concerned, okay, so one thing is it just looks like a regular file system. The fact that files are remote should be transparent to applications. Same code should run, whether you're accessing a local file or remote file. All of this is happening inside the OS. The clients don't know. Users don't see this happening. It just looks like you issued a read. Okay, you just opened the file in your browser or your editor, say. All this is happening underneath. You shouldn't know or shouldn't care. Okay. So no special things are necessary from the application side just to access NFS file. It's the job of the NFS client and the server to implement whatever optimization they want to implement to make this efficient. They can implement caching or not. All that is a design decision. Okay. So the main takeaway here is NFS used to be a stateless design for a distributed file system, and now it has become a stateful design. And we'll see what why the state allows us to do certain things in NFS version 4 that you couldn't do before. Okay, but before I talk about that, I just want to briefly mention this mount protocol that I'm assuming some of you have heard of already. Now, this is a more general mechanism. Okay, so typically to access any networked volume or any file on a remote machine, you have to first establish a connection with the server. Okay, you have to create, let's say, a network drive or create a network volume. Okay. In the case of NFS, this is done through a protocol called the mount protocol. Okay, I assume either in Windows or Mac OS X, you have constructed a network drive, you mounted a volume. Okay, and then that volume becomes accessible, and then you can just simply CD into it or double click on the volume and start accessing it. But before you start accessing it, you have to first establish that mapping between the local machine and the server. And this is what the mount protocol allows you to do. So here's your server. Okay, the server has a set of home directories, and here are two clients that have simply taken that home directory and established a mapping. Okay, and what that mapping essentially says is, take this volume or take this subtree from the server and pretend that it is attached to this point within the local file hierarchy. So what that means is, if you actually access any file along this path at this point, so all of those requests will be sent straight to the server. Any other paths will be locally handled. It's completely transparent. So you will basically be able to establish, and you can establish whatever mapping you want. This is done at boot time. There is a table called file system table, FSTAB. You provide these mappings in FSTAB, and then once you boot up, those mappings are constructed, and then when you CD into a particular directory, you can actually get access to this. Equivalent things being done in Windows would be to construct, let's say, your F drive or E drive, that's a network drive. You specify the server name, you specify volume on the server name, and you map it to a letter drive. So when you actually access that letter drive, you're accessing files on the server. And over Macs also have a similar strategy where you can use Apple file protocol or some such technique to construct a network volume. Okay, so all file systems use some way to construct this mapping. Okay, with a network volume or a volume on a server is then made accessible locally. Okay. Now there are some interesting implications that come up when you have things like a mount protocol. Here is one of them. Okay. So let us say the following happens. There are two servers and there is a client. Okay. Here is server B, which has, let's say, some application code, okay, some set of applications that are mounted by server A. Okay. So these are some packages that are made available. Server A itself has some other packages that it has made available to a client. So the client has basically, so it's slash, let's say this is slash bin. All the binaries are mounted from server A. So all of the utilities that you have on the machine come from server A. Okay. Now question is, since this server has first taken some of these files and mapped it locally, and then it has exported this subtree to a client, should this client get access to files that are stored on that server? Okay. Should the transitivity property hold for the mount protocol? Server A mounts a volume from B. Okay? It then exports a higher level hierarchy volume, which includes that volume. Okay, in the hierarchy, it includes the volume to another client. Should now server B's files become accessible to a client or not? Okay. So you're saying yes. Okay. There are only two answers, yes or no. Anybody say no? Okay, so you can do it either way, but there are implications of what you do. Okay. So typically, let's say you go with the yes case. Okay, so then what happens is A has mounted a volume from B. It has exported a higher level volume to a client. Client gets access to server B data. This implicitly says that the level of trust, or your trust, is transitive. Okay. Let's say the system administrator on B has trusted A to mount its volume. So when you export any volume, you can specify your trust group saying only these machines should be allowed access to this that volume. Okay. So clearly A is trusted by B, which is why it has been allowed to mount. Now if A then goes and re-exports that file to some arbitrary client without B's knowledge, okay, then the level of trust has expanded beyond what B has intended it to be. Because A can export its volume to any client it wants to provide access to. Okay. This is not under B's control anymore. Okay. Now suddenly files on A have become exposed to some third client that it never intended to export. Okay, so if you allow transitive property, you have to ensure that your trust is going to be more loose, that you trust whoever you have trusted also trusts. Okay, because B has trusted A trusts client to access its volume. So now as a result, B has to expect to trust the client if you allow this to happen. Okay? Or you can say this is not allowed. Okay? The files are only accessible to the machines that they are directly exported to. You cannot re-export them. If you do this, then if you try to access this part of the file hierarchy, okay, this client is going to get an error. The error is going to be you send this request off to this server. The server is then going to basically say that this is an exported volume. It shouldn't be accessible to the client because that's B's volume. It's not my job. Okay, and deny access to the file. So you can do it either way. Now, the way NFS did it is the trust was direct. You could not export the re-export volumes. So if you take a volume that's mounted and re-export on a higher level volume, the client will actually not even see these files. But later versions of NFS allow you to decide what trust levels you want. Some other file systems also make this decision either way. So it simply comes down to if you want to have direct control over who accesses your files, you shouldn't allow transitivity. Because you do not know what the machine that is accessing your files has itself done with respect to other machines. Important, small but important point that comes up in the context of mount protocol. Okay? Because there are security implications. You don't know who else might have accessed these files or you may not control that machine. Yes.
Is there any way to have like a security model where it's kind of like similar to Kerberos where you don't just explicitly like trust transitively like what you're saying, but you know have like kind of a multi-realm kind of security implementation?
Yeah, so you can have very many different security models that are layered on top of this. This is a very straightforward one. NFS may run on Kerberos, it may run on many other protocols that allow you to do this, but then if you have a re-exported volume, you basically send those requests not to server A, but server B, and server B can decide whether it wants to give access or not. It doesn't come through one level of indirection. Here, you're getting one level of indirection. The server is almost acting as a proxy. Because this client accesses this file, that request is sent off here because this entire volume is accessed. If this server then accesses that file and sends it over, server B doesn't even know that client was requesting the file. It thinks the server was requesting the file. Right? You can break that indirection by saying, if you have remounted partitions, you have to make a direct request. You can't go through intermediaries to get that file. But just to answer, so different answer from what you were asking. There are different security models. NFS doesn't even mandate a particular model. Different models work with NFS and many other file systems as well. Okay. The environment has to pick the one that makes the most sense. Okay, that's dependent on the system administrator to decide what they will allow and not allow. Okay, so that is about mount. The last point about mounting, and then we'll move on to other topics within NFS, is auto mounting. The auto mounting is simply a mount protocol that allows you to mount on demand. Okay. So what that means is the mappings are already established, but unless there's active activity, you do not actually mount that file because that's unnecessary state you're keeping that. So if you simply CD into that directory on the client, okay, it is automatically mounted on demand. This often happens for volumes that are all flagged as auto mount. Okay, there will be a whole bunch of them. And then you will basically create that mapping on the fly. Okay, and then you will, if there is no further activity, if the last file has been closed, you'll keep it active for 5 or 10 minutes and then you'll time out and say, there's no activity on this volume, let's unmount it. Okay, this avoids you from creating lots of needless mounts. Okay, otherwise, any large distributed system or a workstation would have might have to mount 20, 30, 50 different volumes, even though the users on that machine may be accessing only a small fraction of those. Okay, so this is a performance optimization. You don't create a needless state. So if you go to the Ed Lab next time to submit your code, you can look at this. You can actually do a listing of what volumes are actually mounted. And then if you CD into some other volume, you'll see that it gets mounted on demand. Okay, that's called auto-mounting. Okay, most Unix operating systems will support this. Okay, auto-mounting is also used when you log into a machine. Okay, your home directory is not always mounted. When you do login, the home directory is mounted on the fly. Okay, that's another use of auto-mounting. Okay. So with that, we'll talk now about the implications of the NFS interface. We'll look at implications of what happens because it's stateful and stateless and so on. Okay, so first of all, I showed you a whole set of calls earlier. Okay? And so those are all calls that are part of the NFS specification, the interface. Now, NFS was designed to be a very general network file system that's supposed to work on any other type of local file system. And because it was so general, what NFS does is it requires very little support from what the underlying file system is. It makes very few assumptions about what the underlying file system should or should not support. As a result of that design decision, it has been ported to a very wide variety of different file systems. Okay, so here are what are referred to as mandatory file attributes in NFS. So what this says is the underlying file system should at least support these attributes on every file, which is the type of the file, whether it's a file or a directory, the size of the file, and some indicator to show whether the file has been changed. That could be a timestamp and so on. That is all that your underlying file system has to store. Okay, so you will see that there is very little here. You are not even storing the owner of the file, okay? Any protection information on the file, and so on. Okay? And because of this decision, it works with very rudimentary file system. Let's say the FAT file system is a very rudimentary one. It doesn't actually have the notion of owners and so on. Okay, all files are accessible to all users. You can't have any protection information and say you cannot access this file. Every file is accessible. Okay. If NFS said your file system has to support ownership, it has to support proper security, it wouldn't be able to work on a FAT file system fundamentally. Okay, those would be incompatible because NFS interface requires something from the underlying file system that the file system may not provide. Okay. So they deliberately made a decision which said that to make it very general and have it work on a variety of different underlying file systems, what you require of the file system is very little. This is all you require. These are mandatory attributes. Here are the set of recommended attributes. So these are attributes that would be nice to have. It would make the NFS implementation more robust. So here you will see things like the owner of the file, access control list, which is protection information. This is not required. But if it is there, it makes the job of NFS much easier in order to decide who to give access to a file and who not to give access to a file. Okay. So what are the requirements of the underlying file system are split into two. The mandatory requirements and what are referred to as the recommended ones, which are the ones that are nice to have. So if you have the mandatory ones, you can port NFS or run NFS on that file system. And if you have the recommended ones, the implementation can do more in terms of allowing user proper control over file accesses and so on. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about file semantics, and that will bring us into other things like locking and so on, which you will see why stateful or stateless decision makes sense. Okay. So file semantics or file sharing semantics basically are rules or properties that the file system guarantees that clients will see when they exhibit certain behavior. In particular, when you see a write to a local file, what happens to the results of that write? Unix semantics says every file operation is instantly visible to all processes. This is called Unix semantics. Any file system that guarantees it has to ensure that whenever a write hits, any subsequent read on that file we'll see the results of that write. Okay. So those are called unique semantics. So you can have many different kinds of semantics. So session semantics say all changes are visible once the file is closed. Okay. Much weaker semantics which says that you can make local operations to a file. When the file is closed, you can send all the changes to the server. Until then, other users may see old version of the file. Okay. So those are session semantics. You can have immutable files which says that you cannot even change a file. When the file is made, you can only read it and not write it. You write it, you make a new version of the file. Okay. There are transactional semantics which provide you transactional properties. Okay. Certain files, just distributed file systems, will pick some of the semantics as we will see. Now, more importantly, in the case of NFS, the interface only requires you to implement session semantics, not Unix semantics. And the interface says, once a write is made, okay, there is no reason to instantly make it visible to all the clients. So clients then can actually cache the read request, send it at a later time to the server. Right? As a result, if you make a write and some other client on some other machine reads the same file, it is okay from an NFS perspective to hand over an old version of the file. Okay. In fact, you will see this happen. If you have a home directory and you can log into two simultaneous machines, open a file on one, okay, write to that file, okay, and save, and then open that file immediately on the second one, many a times you will actually see the old version of the file being returned by the server because the first client hasn't even sent those changes. So in this scenario, your network files, this NFS semantics, are different from what you expect a local file system will give. On a local file system, this can never happen. There are two processes on one machine that are accessing the same file. One process writes and the other process reads afterwards. It will always see the previous write. Okay? In NFS, that does not have to be the case. Okay? Because all that the interface says is you implement session semantics. So if you wanted Unix semantics, you would have to use the remote access model, okay? Which means every read or write are immediately sent to the server. So any subsequent read or write from any other client, since they're sent to the server, then you get the most recent. And that, since that is expensive, you are only required to implement session semantics, which means you can use local cache. Reads and writes don't have to go immediately to the server. In fact, most implementation cache every write for up to 30 seconds. Okay, once a write hits, it may take 30 seconds for the client to actually send those writes to the server. Okay, so you may get up to a 30-second delay before anything comes over. Now, this brings us to this whole notion of file locking. So again, there is a difference between how locking of files is handled in local file system and NFS. Okay, so first of all, you should know what file locking is. Okay, file locks allow you to take a lock on the file, whether it's a read lock or a write lock, to ensure that no other process can perform operations on that file, if you have a read or a write lock, for instance. Okay. Now locking, the first thing you have to realize is locking is a stateful operation. Okay. You grab a lock on the file, somebody is keeping track of that lock state, whether it's free or not. Okay, the lock has a state associated with it. Okay. Now, most local file systems will allow you to do file locking. Okay. Since until NFS version 3, it was a stateless server, okay, NFS did not support locking. Okay, because if it's stateless, there's no way to implement locking, even though your local file system may be stateful, the server is stateless. So you couldn't implement locking. Now, this gave rise to lots of problems because there are many applications that depend on proper file locking for correctness. Okay? Simplest example of an application that uses locking is mail. Okay? Your inbox is a shared file. Okay? That is your SMTP protocol that may be delivering new mail to your file. Your mail clients that are reading from that file. Okay? And they both use locking for correctness purposes. You don't want to be deleting some mail from your inbox while new mail is arriving and have your inbox get corrupted. Okay, so the way all of this work is you grab a lock, you make the changes, you release the lock. Okay. So because NFS did not support locking, okay, you couldn't run mail applications correctly on NFS mounted volumes. Okay. You would occasionally get errors. So if you actually read NFS documentation or some mail documentation, it will say that if your inboxes do not remote mount inboxes over NFS because there will be corruption. You may be reading it locally and some new mail may arrive, and since locking is not supported, you may have bad results and your file may, or mail may actually disappear or get corrupted. Okay. As of version 4, because it is stateful, okay, the NFS interface has implemented locking. So that now allows you to keep state and implement locking. This is one important advantage of making it a stateful operation. So in particular, here are some primitives that NFS now supports. You can create a lock, and you can lock a range of bytes. You don't have to lock the entire file. You can just say lock bytes 10 through 100. So only that part of that file is going to be locked. The rest of the file can still be accessible. You can, of course, lock the entire file as well. So you can release the lock, you can renew the lock, and so on. Okay, so all of these operations are now supported in NFS version 4 as a result of it being stateful. Any questions on file locking? Has anybody used file locking? Okay, so if you actually write any distributed application that accesses files, you should use file locking like databases and so on. So a little more details about how locks work. So here is two tables. I don't think we have to go into too much detail here. That simply says that locks could be of two types. It could be a read lock or a write lock. And depending on what the current state of the file is, when you make a request for a read write or a write lock, then certain things, it may succeed or not succeed. So in particular, if you already have, so what is the top, the row here is what is called file denial state. It is what kinds of operations shouldn't be supported. So if you have file denial state is none, which means all operations are allowed, you can grab any kind of lock you want, a read lock or a write lock. The file denial state is read, which means reads are no longer allowed. Then if you try to get a read lock, it will fail. Okay, that's why it says fail. The file denial state is write, but so that means that writes are not allowed, but reads are allowed, then it will succeed. And typically, you will either have none or both. So either both operations shouldn't be allowed or all operations are allowed. So in this case, either reads or writes will either both succeed or they will both fail. Okay, but you can do anything if depending on what you're trying to achieve. Okay. And it should be clear how read-write locks work. The read-write lock, there are multiple readers, but only one writer. And concurrent reads are allowed, but when you're writing, no one else can read or write. Okay, so typically, you will use, rather than a global lock, you can acquire the lock in read mode or write mode. Okay, if you acquire it in read mode, others can read. Okay, but before you write, you have to get a write lock, which at that point, no one else can read or write. That's a mutually exclusive lock. Okay. So that brings us to this whole notion of caching, and we'll come back at this point to the upload-download mode. So caching is allowed in NFS because only session semantics are required. You do not have to send all the reads or writes immediately. So what that allows client applications to do is to bring the file over or cache portions of it so that reads and writes could be local, and periodically they're flushed to the server. Now most, as I already said, most implementation allowed cache data to be kept locally for up to 30 seconds before they're flushed. So what that means is the server state may be outdated for as much as 30 seconds after a client modifies the file. Okay. So consistency is not even strong. Okay, if you remember when I was talking about consistency, I said most actual systems never implement strong consistency. Here is an example of a very weak form of consistency. It's not even a guarantee. It says once you modify it, you can sit until for 30 seconds before you even do anything about this write. Okay. Until then, clients are going to see old versions. So in an NFS environment, if you actually make a change to your source code and you go to another build machine and say build, and your code is stored on an NFS server, you better wait at least 30 seconds because your write or your save will not even hit the server for that 30 seconds. If you start the build process, it may pick some old version of the file and start building. Okay, so you will get errors of this sort in an NFS environment because of these problems. What's the main reason? So first thing is NFS interface doesn't require or even say anything about caching. It only specifies here are the APIs, this is the API you want to implement. And it says that you have to at least implement session semantics, no more. So now you are NFS designer. You are writing your NFS client and server. You have to make design decision. Think, what do you do? Okay, how do you provide good performance? So you could certainly implement the remote access model where every client reads and writes are sent to the server. Performance is going to be slow because there is going to be a network hop in between. Okay? So you will say, how do I give my users good performance? You have to cache. You will say, does NFS prohibit caching? Does it say anything about caching? It's completely silent about caching. All it says is implement session semantics. So you can say, yeah, I can implement caching and still satisfy session semantics. Because session semantics says that all changes have to be sent when the file is closed. So you say, I'm going to send it every 30 seconds. I won't even wait until file is closed. Better than what session semantics requires. Right? So now you are fully compliant with respect to the interface. NFS didn't say anything about caching, but by implementing caching, you give better performance. This is how most of the code has been written. This is not what NFS requires to do. This is how implementations work. Okay. So they are all part of trade-off. Right? So you give better performance, but you have weakened consistency. In most cases, that's an okay trade-off, simply because the observation is it will be rare that two different processes or two different machines are accessing the same file. That's a somewhat rare scenario. If it's a home directory and you're logged in, typically you are the only one accessing. So you optimize for the common case. The rare case is going to give you occasional problems. That is basically how it works. Okay. Any other questions on this? Okay, so that's client caching. Now we'll look at what the stateful server allows us to do. Okay, because the server is stateful, the server also allows what is called explicit delegation. So in this case, when the client first opens the file, the server can say, is this the only client accessing the file? If it is yes, then it can say, here is a local copy and you take over the responsibility of the server. So the master has been actually changed. The server delegates the responsibility of being a master to this client. If the client is not caching at this point, it actually has a master copy of the file because the server has sent the copy over. So in this case, not only are all file accesses local, you are actually making those operations on a copy that the server has given you. The server is not even the master at this point. So this is what is called delegation. Now, the server in NFS is allowed to always recall the delegation, saying, I want to take over being the master. Okay? And in this case, the client has to send the file back, and you're back to the remote access model with caching. So what happens is the common case where the client is the only one accessing a particular file, it is okay to delegate. So you don't even have to cache, you just delegate the entire file. So this client becomes a master, accesses are local at that point on the master copy. You don't even have to periodically send changes. When the delegation is called back, you send the file with the changes. And if multiple clients open the file, okay, then you recall the delegation and you are back to the old model. So this is backward compatible. So in the common case, you can delegate files. And you can only do this because the server is allowed to be stateful. It has to keep track of what you have delegated, that state. If you didn't know what you have delegated because you're stateless, then you cannot recall anything back. But because you are allowed to be stateful, you are allowed to do these things, which is delegate. So this is the equivalent of upload-download model in NFS. By delegating a file, you basically downloaded a file, all changes are local. And then when the delegation is taken back or the server, the client gives it up, you basically send the file back. Okay. So in NFS, you have both. You have upload-download model as part of delegation in version 4, you have both. And you have remote access model with caching, that is a common case. Okay, so both of those are supported. So the last part here, before we end, is how failures are handled in the case of NFS, in particular RPC failures. So I already mentioned NFS runs on top of RPCs. Original versions of RPCs use UDP, not TCP. So in fact, very early versions were simply because this was a LAN-based application, you simply send those RPC requests or UDP, which means that RPCs can messages can be lost in the network. Okay. Replies can be lost as well. Okay, now the reply, so the NFS client code is has code in there which uses timeouts. If you do send RPC request, do not get a reply, you retransmit. If you use TCP, this would not happen because the TCP would retransmit for you. You don't have to do it at the NFS client level. But because the client is designed to run over TCP or UDP, it has to have extra mechanisms which have timeouts and retransmits. Okay. Now, that brings the question of if you retransmitted an RPC request. Okay, here is request number 1234. It reached the server. Okay. Server processed it, but the reply was lost in this case. Since the reply was lost, the client has retransmitted the request. So then the question is, how should the retransmitted RPCs be handled at the server? Now you could simply say, whenever a request comes in, I don't care if it's a duplicate request or the original request, I simply execute the request and send back a reply. So in this case, request number 1234 will be processed twice. If you're retransmitting an RPC request, if you say the previous reply didn't reach, so I'm going to re-execute the request and send back a reply, okay, you could take that tack and try to re-execute. Okay. Now, the problem with blindly re-executing requests is there will actually be issues when you re-execute. So, for instance, let's say you use the RPC request was create a file. Okay. First create came in. Let's say that's that request. Create request comes in, you create the file. Okay. And you send an ACK saying fire, create succeeded, the ACK was lost. Next create comes in. Okay. It's creating the same file. Technically, if a create request comes and the file exists, you have to return an error. Okay. Saying the file already exists, I can't recreate the file. So if you blindly try to execute the second create, this time the RPC will return an error. So now you have a problem. Okay. Or you can think of an append request. You are trying to append some data to the end of the file. Okay. First request came in, you appended something, some characters to the end of the file. Send back a reply saying write succeeded or append succeeded, reply was lost. RPC was retransmitted, you got an append. Okay. Now you re-execute, you appended the same data again. Now your file contents are inconsistent. Okay. You have appended or returned twice. When you should have only done it once. That's another problem. So what this says is something that I had also mentioned earlier is whenever you retransmit an RPC request, you have to have an implementation that ensures that the RPCs are idempotent. Okay? Which means no matter how many times you execute it, you should have the same end result. Okay? You cannot have a different end result depending on whether you executed it previously. So if in scenarios where you have to do this, where you timeout and retransmit the RPC request, the implementation in NFS has to be idempotent. The way this is done is what you actually do is you track whenever your request is executed, you keep a log, okay, you keep a cache of what are some recent RPC requests that you have executed and what were the replies for those RPC requests. Okay. When a request comes in, you check, did I actually execute request number 1234 already? Okay, since that request would have just been sent previously, it would be in the cache saying this request was executed, here was the reply. Okay. If the request has been executed and the reply was generated, you simply pick the reply from the cache and you retransmit the reply, which was lost previously. Okay. So you basically don't execute a request that was already executed because otherwise your system will not have idempotent properties. You keep track of the replies and keep a log of recent RPC executions and the reply. You see the same request and it's been executed, resend the reply. You don't have to do anything. Is that clear? Okay, this is basically a simple strategy to implement. So this is what is actually shown here. Request comes in, reply is lost, but it was cached. Request is resent again. You pick up the reply from the cache and you resend. Any RPC system that requires idempotency would have to do something like this. Okay. Or you could just say, I only support TCP. Okay. Then it's not the RPC system's problem. TCP will retransmit and you will not have this problem at all. The application level, you will always see one request going out and one reply coming back. Okay. Whether the network retransmit is not your problem. Your application is going to ride on TCP. Okay. But early versions of NFS did not require it. They said any RPC system should work. In particular, if the RPC runs on UDP, it should also work. So you have to have application level failure recovery. Okay. So this is referred to as a duplicate request cache. Okay. So what that also says is every request, every RPC request needs to come in with a unique ID. So that you can log it onto the client, onto the server, and if the next same request is retransmitted, you can figure this out. And the request IDs have to be unique across the system, not on just the machine. It has to come with some ID. Okay, the last thing here is on security, which is what was asked very early on. So there are many things you have to do in NFS to ensure security. One is, the client has to, or the server has to authenticate what clients are accessing it. Yeah. So the simplest thing that is done is when the server exports a volume, you provide a list of machines that are authorized to access it. And when they make a mount request, depending on whether you are in the list or not, you are going to allow or deny. That simple authentication. Okay. Now, subsequent RPC requests are going to go unencrypted over the network. So when you try to access a file, the RPC request and the RPC response goes unencrypted. So the connection is not secure in default NFS. What you can actually do in NFS version 4 is you can run this over secure RPC. Okay, this is like running it over SSL. That means that this is a secure socket. Any data that goes out is encrypted. Any response that comes is encrypted. This is handled by the RPC layer. So you don't have to actually encrypt at the NFS layer. You just hand it to something that's equivalent to an SSL layer, which is going to encrypt it for you. Yes, for sure.
So, can you implement this with like your own key pair, or does this do like some sort of DH exchange for you? Or
so you will see that the RPC sec implementation can ride on a number of different security protocols. It can run on Kerberos. It can run on your own security protocol that you decide should work with this implementation. So NFS doesn't require you to use a particular implementation. Whatever is exists in that environment can be used in the context of securing the communication. Okay? But by default, none of this happens. By default, after the initial authentication, all reads and writes are sent unencrypted. Okay? This is the same as HTTP and HTTPS. In HTTP, you can use password-based authentication where the password may be encrypted, but then all subsequent HTTP requests and responses are unencrypted. HTTPS encrypts all the data that's flowing back and forth as well. Same considerations are true here as well. Okay, so you can encrypt all the reads and writes as well as the initial authentication. And the only important takeaway is there are two, which is one is you can use any crypto system here. Okay, we haven't come to security yet, but when you come to it, we look at some of these. And they're all compatible. And the second is this is handled by the RPC subsystem. The NFS code sits on top, as you see. It doesn't deal with it. It simply says use encryption, and then and it specifies what type of encryption to use, and the RPC system will use it. Okay, so the RPC system has to be designed to use some of these techniques. Okay. So that's secure RPC in NFS version 4. So NFS version 4 also implements an equivalent, just as your HTTPS, your secure version of. So let me stop here for today. Okay, we have the exam tomorrow, but next week we will resume this discussion and talk about other file systems. And that will show you how other file systems have made other design decisions. Okay, you saw what NFS has done, but there are many out there that do some very different things. Okay, so let's stop. And if you have questions about the exam, I am around today and tomorrow. Come by, talk to me.